So for people with type 1 diabetes, there can be a steep cost, right, in a few ways. But turning to type 2 diabetes, there's also a steep cost to society there, especially when you consider the fact that many cases of type 2, millions of them, may be preventable. Now, the number of Canadians living with type 2 expected to almost double over a 10-year period. And that rise has a strong link with the rise in obesity, sugar intake, and the fact that we just aren't getting enough exercise. But on the extent to which we can stem the tide of type 2 diabetes and even potentially reverse it, our health panel. Dr. Danielle Martin joining us, Vice President of the Women's College Hospital. Dr. Lennox Huang joining us as well, Chief Medical Officer at the Hospital for Sick Children. And Dr. Samir Sinha, Director of Geriatrics at Mount Sinai Systems and the University Health Network. Thank you to all of you for being here. So there's a lot to talk about, so let's get right into it. And I want to start, Danielle, maybe with you, with the concept of pre-diabetes. According to the Canadian Diabetes Association, millions of Canadians potentially have it. What is it?
Well, I think it's important for us to start out by saying pre-diabetes is not a disease. It's a pre-disease. And so it's important in many cases to identify it. But in and of itself, we don't believe that there are complications from living with pre-diabetes.
It refers to what?
It refers to a rise in the blood sugar that happens as the body's ability to manage the sugar in the blood effectively and pull it out of the bloodstream and store it in the body's tissues, which is a process that is governed by insulin, begins to break down. And if it goes too far, if that breakdown goes too far, then you end up with actual diabetes, which is an actual disease.
And the concern there, as you say, is that it may be a precursor specifically to type 2 diabetes.
That's correct.
So we'll make that delineation clear. So Lennox, can you walk us through what that means for kids?
So for kids, really what it is it sets you up on a different life course. And that's really important because some of what you're going to hear about in terms of the complications of diabetes in adults are made all that much more worse by having type 2 diabetes as a child. And children, we know, also are much more prone to early complications, and in particular the kidneys. So up to 50% of children with type 2 diabetes have some serious kidney problems, and at its very worst could lead to the point of kidney failure and potentially needing dialysis or transplant.
And Samir, at the other end of the spectrum, you work predominantly with seniors. There can be complications.
Yeah, because I think the key is diabetes is one of these conditions that we can live with for many years. And the reason we want to have early diagnosis and effective management, which could be a combination of the things we talked about, is that we can stem the damage that excess sugar in our bloodstream can cause over time. So think about having clean pipes that then get clogged over time, you know, and hardened. And therefore, you see these what we call macro and microvascular complications. Macro being your heart, your kidneys, your brain getting negatively affected with strokes and other things. And those smaller things like your eyes, or even your fingertips losing sensation or even losing vision because those get affected. So I see a lot of those complications in my older patients because they lived a lifetime with diabetes. Right. But we know that those who catch it early and try and manage it as best as possible can sometimes avoid many of those complications and live a relatively healthy life.
Is it fair to say type 2 diabetes is preventable?
For many people, that is a fair thing. But, you know, for all of us, there are some things that we can't change about ourselves. We can't change our genetics. So we know, for example, that some populations in Canada, particularly Indigenous populations, people from South Asian descent are at much higher risk than the general population. We can't change our age, and we can't change our gender. A lot of other things that many of us can't change are some of the social and economic drivers, right, of these illnesses. But for the average person, if we take if we do our very best, we can often, and if we as a society do our very best, we can often prevent the development of type 2 diabetes.
Right, because there is this sort of complex interplay between diet, exercise, obesity, yeah, and diabetes.
Absolutely. You know, what we say is that the course of diabetes is certainly modifiable by lifestyle, environmental factors. And we see in the pediatric and the youth population the rise in type 2 diabetes has directly been correlated with the rise in obesity. So we know if we can target some of the factors that lead to obesity, that we're likely to shift the prevalence of type 2 diabetes.
I think the key is that even for older adults who are living, you know, with diabetes, you know, if you have the luxury of having more time on your hands, then adhering to exercise and other things a little bit more if you can, means that you can actually better manage your diabetes. And in these cases where they talk about reversing almost, you know, what we see is that sometimes if you can actually manage some of those factors better, you might be able to lower the amount of medications you're taking and just have a better overall life.
And do we have any sense at all how many Canadians go undiagnosed?
Lots. I mean, yeah. It's the short answer. Certainly many, many, possibly even millions in that sort of pre-diabetic range, which are, again, people who we feel we can kind of at times intercept and right. just with those lifestyle changes and some focused attention sometimes prevent the development of the disease. And then also many who are undiagnosed with the actual disease itself, and I'm sure that's true in kids too.
Well, and I asked the question because, it was just yesterday I was reading a study out of the UK that looked at the efficacy of early screening for type 2 diabetes, but doing it at local pharmacies,
right?
Which is not something that I'd ever really heard of being done here in Canada. The same way, you know, you might test your blood pressure. Is there a need for a more kind of expansive regime, a program?
Well, it's not necessarily. I think in that study, they weren't talking about being a more expensive regime. They were just saying if there are a lot of people who are going undiagnosed and early diagnosis in that study, they said they were able to diagnose people up to 3 years earlier and get them into interventions, which could just start with lifestyle changes.
And why is that early intervention important?
Well, it's important because if you go 3 years with diabetes and without treatment, for example, all those complications can start mounting up earlier. So hence, you know, this is a mechanism to say that, you know, a person might be more likely to go in. Some of my patients go into a pharmacy 12 times a year, but they may not see their primary care provider as often. Right. So the idea that a simple screen could sometimes be doing a finger blood prick test, for example, or getting a small sample of blood that can tell us, you know, if you're at risk. And so not to say that we should start doing that tomorrow, but it's the idea about how do we promote more early diagnosis and management when it's appropriate.
There's one other thing that I want to raise here. So another study out of England, they tracked hundreds of people who went on low-calorie diets to lose substantial amounts of weight. After a year, almost half were able to reverse their type 2 diabetes, and after 2 years, more than a third were still in remission. Now, it's not a completely new novel concept that type 2 diabetes can potentially be reversed, but this was a larger study. They were able to track people over a much longer period, so that's notable. Danielle, what's the moral here? Because, I mean, the notion that type 2 diabetes is potentially reversible, I mean, that would challenge this idea that it's, you know, this inevitably progressive disease.
I think, you know, it's interesting, there's a double-edged moral on this one. You know, on the one hand, it's a very encouraging sign to think that we have that much agency and control and that we can really stop in its tracks or even reverse the course of a disease like this purely by focusing on those incredibly important treatments, which are diet and exercise. At the same time, I do think that there's another moral, which is that, you know, there are some things, this will work for some people, but not for everybody.
Right.
And we have to be really clear about not blaming people who are sick for their illnesses, and considering also all the social and economic reasons why it might not be so easy for everybody to lose 30 pounds. It might not be so easy for someone to eat healthy or go to the gym or whatever. You know, there are lots of factors beyond our control that society is controlling. And so this is a social conversation, not just an individual conversation.
And I guess in this particular study in England, I mean, the weight loss was quite severe, right, in terms of how they reduced their calorie.
I mean, the average person that was successful in reversing their diabetes, you know, lost about 20 pounds. So this was significant. And those who were most successful in sustaining that loss actually lost about 30 pounds, right? So these are people who we call, like, significantly overweight or obese. But I think that the thing is, you know, they didn't really reverse their diabetes. They didn't reverse their underlying risk factors. They didn't reverse those things that they couldn't change. It's just that their blood sugar levels now consistently were being measured below a level that we would say clinically this is diabetes. But I think, as Danielle was saying, it just reminds us that there's a lot of things we can do that can better control us and put us back into that, I'd call it, safe zone.
Lennox, I'll give you the final word here, because I'm just curious to know, the sum total of the picture. I mean, we've known for a long time that type 2 diabetes, instances of it, are on the rise.
Absolutely.
That it has been getting worse.
Yeah. Yeah.
To what extent is it getting worse? Is it leveling off? Is there hope?
Well, you know, I think our general sense is that it has been increasing dramatically over the past two decades. And when we look at the pediatric population, there is some hope. It looks like it might be leveling off. We don't have the final word on this, but it does look like it might be leveling off. If we look back two decades, maybe three decades, in the pediatric population, this was unheard of. And the rates in the adult population were a lot lower too. So I think it's an interesting commentary on our modern world, the diet, the activities, the exercise, maybe other environmental factors that we're not even aware of that result in this increase. And it's something that bears reflection for all of us.
Lennox, Samir, Danielle, always great to have you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.